Save your applause, for you haven't seen nothing. Yes, I want to show you a CD-ROM, a funny idea. And the idea was by Susie Taylor. He told me I should do a CD-ROM for this occasion here in San Francisco in September 2002. I had no experience in making a CD-ROM. I could design a book, but a CD-ROM was something new for me. But I had good friends who helped me, programming and so. And at the end, we finished it practically in the last moment before our takeoff last Thursday. What you see here today is not the final version. It is a so-called beta test. So you have to be careful with your critics, but we will do our best and we'll change some of the pages. But just this as an introduction that you are not too unhappy what you see. You see, it is normally in a book, you have in front of you the pages and you can find out what is wrong or not. In a CD-ROM, you have to finish all the whole section before you can see something. It's like computers, you see. In the old days, let's say, if you have a problem with your machine, letterpress machine, you took a screwdriver and a hammer and you could fix it in a few minutes. With a computer, you had other problems. I wanted to mention any name of a company, you must be careful. But sometimes you get really nervous if this funny thing doesn't work. And the same was all the time in preparing this CD-ROM. So I will show it to you now, and I have to go down, for I need the help of Linnea. She is the expert in showing the CD-ROM. Good? Yeah, here we are. My voice is not very good. I have not a voice like Fidel Castro, the Maximo leader, or one of these senators from Texas, but I will try my best. So let's start the first picture.
We have technical problems, just a second.
So you see, electronics are perfect and beautiful if they are working. And now we are starting with the problem again. It worked half an hour before. What's the mess?
David Schwabi is fixing it right now.
So I give you a little more information about the CD-ROM. As I told you, it's not finished. It will take some more weeks when I'm back in Germany. And so I think it will be ready by the end of October, mid of October, and you can get it from the Carey Library at the Retro Institute of Technology. They will distribute this CD-ROM in the USA. In Germany, it is the Wolfenbüttel Library, and in Japan, it is the Tokyo Library in Tokyo. So, doesn't that?
We're live, Herman.
Yeah, you need patience if you use computers, you know. So. So you will get a little leporello. Oh, yes, now let's start. You can use this CD-ROM in different ways. You can have it as a film running, or you can have it also to see each page by a mouse click. Now we do it by a mouse click, so it saves time, and you have not to read all this, the lines underneath the pictures. This I will tell you, so we will finish this in time before. Well, it normally takes more than an hour, so you must know this. Next, please. So you have seen, I'm born in Nuremberg. And you see here a few pictures of Nuremberg before it was destroyed during the war. This is a manuscript done 1938. Nuremberg, 1918, as I was born, was not a good place to select if you come to Earth. It was very hard to live there, and in 1980, November 1980, we had in Europe this Spanish flu, which killed more than 20 million people just by this Spanish flu. More people have been killed by this illness than during the whole World War I, on the Allies and on the German front. Nobody knows this, that is such a big difference in the figures. So 20 million killed only by this Spanish flu. Two of my siblings died within 4 weeks, also in 1918. And next. And the conditions in the town, you know, early November 1918, the revolution was in Berlin, and also Nuremberg was affected. And the Kaiser went away to the Netherlands, and the life conditions have been very, very bad. And the doctors gave me not very much time for living. They told me, my mother, you will not live more than a few years, for I was in very bad shape as I was born, and I didn't have enough weight as a normal baby had. But you see, doctors have sometimes wrong decisions. So I'm nearly 83 now, and all the doctors don't live again. Next, please. Other pictures of Nuremberg. All these buildings, many of these buildings are not existing anymore. Those really document this manuscript. Dürer House, they have rebuilt it again. It was also partly destroyed by air raids. Next. This is my first experience in, let's say, lettering or calligraphy, or however you want to call this. Very funny initials, but you have to start once. As early as it's better. Next is a picture of my schoolroom, which we had in these days not always very kind teachers. And this was a picture as I want to have in my memory of all these school years. Next, please. On the left side, there's a funny alphabet. It's a secret alphabet, for my mother shouldn't read everything which I was changing with my brother and with my friends. So I had this lettering done, and she was really sometimes so unhappy, for she didn't know what these notes mean. And on the right-hand side, you see some drawings of self-made toys. My mother didn't, my parents didn't have enough money, so we had practically no toys as child, as kids. And but I had good friends and wealthy friends, so we could play with their toys. This was normal for me. I've never thought why I have no toys and they have. But I had the opportunity, and it was fine. Next, please. In this shoebox is an electrical kit, which I made for myself. You see, I had no money. My parents had no money. And it gives you an idea, as a young fellow who wanted to do something and to use time and was interested in electricity, to get along with all these experimental things. So this is a shoebox with electrical kit. Next. And then I designed also an instruction book for this. So this is the title page, one of my very first book designs, if you take this way. The lettering is not the best, so don't look too careful to this lettering. But at that time, I thought it was good. So next, please. Here you see the instruction book with all the information, how you could, what you could do with this simple electrical kit. Next, please. Something wrong? So I have patience, it comes after a while. Yeah. See, I was not allowed to study electrical engineering, so I had to find a way to do something. And my parents thought I should become a lithographer. So I went to all these companies and showed my designs and pictures, a folio, and they said always, yes, very nice, very good. But after some political questions, they said, we are sorry, we can't take you, or would have problems with you. For my father was very much engaged in the trade unions, and I had the same name as my father, so I had a lot of problems in this case. So the last company in the telephone book, company was called Ulrich, I went to them, after 8 months running through the whole city about this, and showed my work, and they looked at it and said, oh, fine, nice. And the last moment, they didn't ask political questions, but the last moment they said, we are very sorry, we have no lithography. But if you like, you can become a photo retoucher, you can start next Monday. I said, yes. So I went home by a bicycle and looked in the dictionary, what is doing? what is doing in the job of a photo detacher? So I became A photo retoucher is 4 years of apprenticeship. Next, please. During this time, there was an exhibition, a memorial exhibition of Rudolf Koch in Nuremberg. He was also born in Nuremberg, 1876. And there was a memorial exhibition. He passed away in 1934. And I saw his work, and this changed my life, this exhibition. I was so fascinated that I wanted also to become a lettering artist. I went to the library, looked to books. They had two books, which were instruction books for lettering, one by Rudolf Koch and one by Edward Johnson, the same books as my wife used, but far away from me, didn't know her. And in that time was the beginning of my, let's say, career, as I also want to call it, of lettering. What you see here are two cutouts, paper cuts, one in gold paper and one in normal paper, black paper. You have to put all the letters that they connect to get them together if you do it as a paper cut. Next, please. And after I finished my apprenticeship as a photo retoucher, I went to Frankfurt, for Nuremberg was not a good place to live by the political situation in Nuremberg. And Frankfurt was more liberal at that time, still at that time. So I went to Frankfurt and into the workshop of Paul Koch, the son of Rudolf Koch. And here you see a drawing of the house zum Fürstendeck in the, with the red arrow. It was a house built in 1360, but destroyed, unfortunately, in 1944, completely. You see nothing again anymore of this building. The same is here, the riverfront of Frankfurt, completely destroyed, and now with new and ugly houses. Next, please. Koch, Paul Koch was specialized in music printing. And so I did some manuscripts with music notation. Here, Brahms, two pages. And also Beethoven, these two pages, which you can see here. During my time, I went to Frankfurt 1938. During this time, I get connection with the Thai founder, the Stempel AG, through a fellow type historian, Gustav Mori. And I showed them some of my sketches of letters and so, and they found this type, which you see here. This is a drawing of the Kierkegaard fracture. This they wanted to do as a type. I was very happy my first time. They paid me very badly, but after a while, as I was art director of the same company, I told them, which was not very fair from you, that you paid me such a bad salary for this design. And the answer was, yes, therefore we are the better salesmen. It's a nice answer. So next, please. This is a drawing of the working table of the punch cutter who was cutting Kierkegaard, and his name was August Rosenberger. So you see the punches, and you see the tools what he needs for all make a, to make a typeface. Next, please. What you see here is a copy of a manuscript, Flemish manuscript, just to train my hand and to get information how these old fellows of the 16th century or 15th century used the colors. This is a famous German manuscript, the Chronic of the Counts of Kleve. Next. During this time in Frankfurt, I did some book design for publishers and also some manuscript for myself. But the binding to this manuscript has been done much, much later, for I wasn't married at the time with Gudrun. But what is interesting here is the oval in the center of this page is done with a pointed brush. It takes several hours to make it. Today, with a computer, you can do it in a few minutes, and you can have 20 variations of an oval. But at that time, you had to do all by your hand. Next, please. Two pages from these manuscripts. Next. Now, a page from a sketchbook which I did during the war. I was stationed in France, mostly stationed in France, designing maps of Spain. I had a lot of time for myself, and therefore I used this time and did some drawings, watercolors, also lettering. This is a quotation by Rudolf Koch. Two other pages, all from these sketchbooks. Some watercolors here, Weimar, in which I was stationed first, but didn't see Gudrun at that time. Next, please. The Cathedral of Berlin, before it was destroyed, just with a fountain pen, drawing with a fountain pen. Pencil drawing of Potsdam, Sanssouci Palace. Dijon, in which our geographic service was stationed in this building. That is the Pouponnice on the Seine River in Paris. Pencil drawing. But the most time I was in Bordeaux, next to the Spanish border, for we had to do something special maps of Spain and Gibraltar. This was our business there. Here you have a page which is extremely small, and you can see the original size in this booklet which Linotype did about the Zaffino. This is the original size of this quotation by Hans von Weber, done with a Somerville pointed pen. Quite small, I think the letters only 4 millimeters in height. At large, it looks much better. A manuscript which I did also in Bordeaux with pen drawings. Some of the Roman ruins in Bordeaux. Again, the same class, and here also two other pages. I told you I had a lot of time, so I made also some exercises in letters. Here you see, I don't count how many variations of each letter I did, just for fun for myself. Some more drawings from this sketchbook. Chalon-sur-Saône in France, and the right-hand side, this is the Hölderlin Tower in Tübingen in the southern part of Germany. I was stationed in Tübingen in the hospital, therefore I could do this. The end of the war, here, first I was in Heidelberg in the hospital, and then they moved us to Tübingen, for the American army was coming to Heidelberg. During this time, there was an air raid on Frankfurt, and they destroyed my home in the in one of these suburbs of Frankfurt to see how it is, how it looks after an air raid. Next, please. This is a nice text about the situation in Germany 1814, which means it was the same situation as it was 1945. This was after the Napoleon War, and 45, you know what was going on in all these years. Next, please. Also a drawing, a watercolor done in the hospital with one of these insects. The insects is, so the original size is 10 millimeters, 2.5 centimeters, excuse me. Next, please. Manuscript which I did shortly after the war. I was going back to Nuremberg to my parents, for as you have seen, my home in Frankfurt was destroyed. This was done on purple Japanese paper, like a Persian manuscript. The binding also, of course, by Gudrun, flexible binding in dark green leather. Two pages from the same manuscript with a colophon with some Arabic lines. I learned Arabic during my time in the hospital, for I was in a room in which a lot of French soldiers, African soldiers have been, so I learned from them Arabic. There's a nice story about Arabic, but I wanted to tell it now here. You can read it in a book about alphabets. There is a story about the Arabic. We can go through the next pages for the books you have here in the library. That is Pen and Graver, Fate und Stichel. So we can run through quickly. I wanted to wait before the text line is coming out. Let's go next.
Too fast, Herman, they're beautiful.
Yeah, we are running out of time. And this is a plate. All these pages of Pen and Graver have been cut by August Rosenberger in lead. So you see one of his plates, the original plates, and also one of these, you can, I think two of these, you can see here in the library. They have two of the Rosenberger plates here in the building. So nothing is new what I'm showing here. There's another publication done during the war and shortly after the war, Blumenabc flower alphabet. Next is a binding also by Gudrun, of course. And we go through these pages, for the original book is also here in the library, you can see. So you have not to look here. All the pages very long. But here you see the English translations put on, which are not, of course, in the German edition, which is upstairs. They are hand-colored. You see, these are cuts also by Rosenberger and hand-colored. And these butterflies are done with pastel to get this grain of a wing of a butterfly. It's very hard to do, and it's not easy to protect. This is one page, this is the last page. As it's normally the printing from a plate by Rosenberger with a quotation by Leonardo da Vinci. And it, this four, or this design includes four items. You see a description of this anagram, as it is called, H, C, A, P, and F, what it means in German, of course, on this design. I had the idea to do more on this, but I was running out of time at that time. I had to do some other things, and I dropped the idea. Too bad, but too late. What you see next are the end papers of the Blumenabc printed in green color. Next, please. Now we are going more to type design. A quotation by Thomas James Cobden Sanderson with some quotations by other people. The drawing here for Palatino italic, which of course was for metal. You see three of the types. Next, yeah, it's okay. Next, please. The type specimen of Palatino. It's a description of the whole family here on the right-hand side. Here's the Palatino page, a poster done by Microsoft with all the, this is the open typeface of Palatino with more than 1,200 figures for each version. It's a crazy idea, but they wanted to do it. That is a Cyrillic version of Palatino. You see, this is the empty space of Russia, what you see here. The white space of Russia. Coming back to the poster of Microsoft, it was Bill Gates' idea to have a typeface which has every, which will cover every language in using Latin, Cyrillic, or Greek characters. So we had to do it for Armenian and for all these funny countries in Russia and in other places, and ending up with 1,200 characters. It was not a nice job at all. For you see, as a normal European, you don't know all these funny characters which you have in Cyrillic. But the computer is alive, as you know.
Sorry about that, Herman. We have
it's not your fault. It's the computer. Here we are. Oh, you start again. What do we do now?
Start, but I will go back to that section.
Good. Yes. Sorry, I warned you already that we would have problems. Now the first problem is starting. But we will get it again. Yeah, coming back to the type designs, what you see next after Palatino is the beginning of Optima. And Optima started 1950. I was in Italy as a tourist, and in Florence and in Rome, and did sketches of Roman inscriptions. And especially in Florence, I was in Santa Croce and was doing sketches from these gravestones in the floor of Santa Croce. And I didn't have any paper with me, so I used two 1,000 lira banknotes and put my sketches on the banknotes. You will see them soon. And I think it's not the normal use of banknotes, but it was the only way to get it on paper. You can go into the years. Yeah. It must be 1950. So Optima started in Florence, and it was also my first idea to name the face Fiorentina. That means Florence. But the temple people didn't like this idea and had changed it to Optima, which I think is not a good name for a typeface of such a classical typeface. Too overdone, Optima. Why Optima? So Beethoven is helping us over to get the note. Oh yes, yeah. Go into next, into 46, yes. Yes, you can go through now. Oh, maybe we will jump over. No. But I told you this is a test version, and therefore you have to see sometimes the same picture twice. Here's the flower alphabet. If you go into 70 and you go back, maybe the easiest way. Go. It's not better to go out and to go. Now all the typefaces are coming now. Yeah, go ahead. Yes, here you see the drawings for linotype altars with a mobile, which I have in my home. Here you see these letters turning around, and the letters are connected with our family. C is our son Christian. Then we have H, and we have G, and at the end, X, Y, and Z. That is a mobile always turning. Here's a normal drawing. The italic also done for linotype. This is Melior. You see linotype matrices on the edge. The other type designed for stamples called visible figures, in connection with Melior. Also Melior redesigned for the photo composition machine, with some explanations of the drawing. And here you see this 1,000 millilire banknotes with the drawings of Optima. This was the start of Optima. I discovered these just by accident a few months ago in an Italian book. So I'm very happy that I have really the first drawings. I always thought my design, which I did for Stempel, was the very first, but here you see it started much earlier. Next, please. Some drawings here, Santa Croce, and also some inscriptions in Florence and in Rome. You see that the structure of Optima with this outline, a little Chinese-looking outline, and a specimen sheet of the temple foundry of the 36-point Optima. Next, please. And Optima is used here in this country for the Vietnam Veterans Memorial in Washington. All these more than 50,000 names done with Optima. Here was, yeah. This was some other design for stempels, Arabic, two different versions. For I told you I had some experience in Arabic, not under the best conditions, but I learned quite a lot. It was very interesting to learn Arabic. Next, please. Some Greek characters, that is calligraphy. Next, please. Now, some of my publications, the Manuale Typographicum 1954, the first one in 16 different languages. The second one was 68 with 18 different languages. If you can go so quickly. These are so-called Primavera ornaments, what you have seen with his initials. A typeface done by my wife. Ariadne initials. Here's some pages of a competition, Liber Librorum, done in Stockholm by the Royal Library in Stockholm. And these are two proposals for Bible pages. And here also in Stockholm, it's a very famous Swedish author, Carl Michael Bellman, a character like Walt Whitman, I would say. And he did very funny songs and so on. Here you see, it's done like you use red wine, let's say, on a paper nap. It's the same idea with the effect of a lipstick. Especially for, if you know more about Charles Baudelaire, Paris, and all this, was the title page here. Next, please. This is not very good in the reproduction here. Done on gray Japanese paper. And it's very hard on this paper, for it's not dyed, you see. It's not sized. So it's very hard to write on. But I wanted to get a possibility to show that it could be done. Here, other page also on Japanese, purple Japanese paper done for Philip Hofer in Cambridge, Massachusetts. The preamble of the Charter of the United Nations done for the Fairbairn Morgan Library in New York, 1960. Now some book design, Bucolica, with woodcuts by Aristide Maillol, done in the Diotima typeface of my wife, italic and Roman. The italic is the German text, for German is running much longer, so I needed a small running typeface, and the other face was some stone again. Go into 17. We can go back. But you see how much space you need if you make such a
It worked perfect before we started here this afternoon, isn't so?
Yes, we tested it 3 times and it yes. worked perfect.
What we can do to go through all this again, and you go back and you go, no? Ah, so if you go back into the 1970 and go back from this, doesn't work now. Oh. No, it hurts. Yeah. Oh, next. Now, here we are again. This is this publication done in Diotima, Italic, and Roman. These are woodcuts by Mayol. Why it jumps again? No, it. Yeah, so other publications, typographic variations here, which you can see also upstairs in the libraries, they have all my publications. And so we can go through this very quickly. Some more pages. Manuale Tipografico with the 18 languages. Some book designs for German publishers. Using wood engravings by Doré, also for this Balzac edition. This is the dust jacket. American Theater was a whole series of books in different colors of the different language countries. With the title page, and maybe come back to the title page. The title page shows also the contents. So you have just an idea to do it. Next, please. An edition of Shirodu in 2 volumes with a pencil drawing of Shirodu. Next. This is Brahms. Publication about Brahms, and with crayon, done with a crayon. Here's this portrait of the young Brahms. You know, Brahms normally is shown with his long beard, you see, 19th century beard. Next step. Here, drawing with a pencil of Talleyrand. Was not a nice fellow at all. You see it very clear here. During the French Revolution, Then there's a publication, a private publication by a German publisher, Amintas. Next, please. This is the use of Diotima typeface of my wife, and it's by Cassinari, it's Aquatint Illustrations, designer, artist living in Milano. Next. Now we are coming closer to Jack Stauffacher. The Set Antiqua was a name within the company, which the real name is Hunt Roman. You see on the third column, top of the third column, Stauffacher. Next to Stauffacher, Josephine, his wife. Then you see also Hunt in the first row. So just to show how the letters are connected within words. So this, and the idea of doing the Hunt Roman was by Jack Stauffacher to Mrs. Hunt. And she liked to have an own typeface for her own, for her private publications. It's used now by the Hunt Botanical Library in Pittsburgh. Next. This is a broadside as a commission for the Container Corporation of America in Chicago with different languages, with quotations in different languages. Next, please. Also, dual-lingual in German and Italian, a Michelangelo sonnet with a translation by Rainer Maria Rilke. Next. Here, I think you know this, here in done for the San Francisco Public Library. You can see it upstairs, the original, so you have nothing to look at here. Next is a sheet for a collector here in Santa Barbara who wanted to have historic lettering done with new quotations. So this is in a style of an historic typeface, not typeface, excuse me, alphabet. Next. Unfortunately, not very good to see. It is a big sheet, and you can see it as the Song of the Sun by Echnaton, and it's a silk screen printed on acetate, so you could put it on a window and the sun shines through. This was the idea behind this. It was very complicated to print on acetate. Now we are going to the hallmark time. This some sketches for the hallmark Anschel done on a sheet. It's a printed sheet of this cross here. Just to show how the type could be. Also for hallmark, the textura, hallmark textura, drawings, and the final type, done for photo composition. This was done at Trick Zurich's time, I guess. Free written letters for a Christmas card and executed in Kansas City on parchment. Next, please. Now, at this time, during my time with Hallmark, we had some ideas to get book production, let's say, a little more organized, and to find ways to reduce, as it all is, which is normal in big companies, to reduce the cost for the publications. So we figured out, and I figured out with some new ways of concentrating with some special to get a production done in the program. So you had to put together different kinds of designs, and you get out maybe a design which is within a series, very easy to produce. So for a standard size for the publications, we had only one format. So you had not very much varieties in the type area. The pictures you could have free at that time, and this, they wanted to get it more and more done as a regular production. So Tolmike was the first who was interested in typographic computer program, not computer typographic programs. Computer programs was later. This is now my connections with RIT. This is cut in aluminum and was connected with my Gaudi Award 1969 at RIT. Next. This is the entrance at RIT with this beautiful design by Joseph Albers. Here, my connections also with RIT, with type, metal type, still with metal type at that time. And this was done for Ben Lieberman in New Rochelle, New York. Standard lay of the case, the Californian case, I think it's called. Here's a design which I did for Hallmark, which never was used. Some ideas about calligraphy next to this. Next, please. Now you see some of this funny way of doing calligraphy, not with a pen. This is scratched into the surface of a prepared panel, and I scratched it with a steel cut like a broad-edged pen. So all this what you see is not done with a pen, but with a steel prod. All this is, you see, the first you paint this black, then you overlay it with white, and then scratch out, and you get all this lettering. It looks like it is done directly on this white surface. I did several of these huge panels, not very small. Next. Another one here is a quotation by Paul Standard. This is in Greek and in German, quotation by Plato. This is a tricky thing of my American programmer. He wanted to show his talent. Why not? Maybe change this a little, but it gives you an idea what you can manipulate in these days. Yeah. Next. So this is a normal panel. Something lettering or calligraphy done on Japanese gold paper. It's real. This is what is how you call this. What is it called? Gold leaf. Yes, on gold leaf. It's not easy to write on gold leaf. You have to find out a way that it's so hard that it doesn't normally take the ink. But you find ways. You have to find ways. Thank you.
Your secret trick.
That is one of the secret trick number five. Yes, other page is a quotation by Lao Tse. Next, please. Then the same on silver leaf. But silver leaf took the color, but not the gold. I don't know why. It's the same material, also metal. Next, please. This is a big one with also all scratched into the surface. The surface was first white and then it overpainted with black, and then you scratch it out and you get the white letter. This is done with oil paint, not with, as they are all done with tempera, but this is done with oil paint. Sentence by Jerzy Lake, which is very hard to translate. Going to 90. I think you can go back if you are in. Yeah? Oh, no, you can't go back. Mm-hmm. Yeah, no, no. Stay, stay, it's good. Some broadsides which I did during my time with RIT. Here a letter to Gutenberg, signed by Alexander Lawson and Proven and myself. We wrote to him and tell him or want to inform him what's going on with his new techniques in digital type. And then next to this is a quotation. Can you get it? A quotation about photo lettering, what you have to remember if you do something in photo lettering, done for Edward Rosenthal in New York, who was the inventor of photo lettering in 1936. And this was one of his birthday presents, which I did. Next. A poster done for RIT, my typographic computer programs. Next, please. This is a layout or diagram for instruction. If you are starting with calligraphy or with lettering, and if you have problems, how far you can go and what you have to make if you go back. There's an English translation also that you see if you get confused, you have to go back to your base and all this. It gives you all your help that you need. It's the same in your computer, you have also on top help. It's the same here for calligraphers. Next is. Now we are here in Stanford. This is the Euler design, which was the idea of Dr. Donald Knuth, who is here with us tonight, today. And we started to have a typeface, especially for mathematics, in Roman, Greek, fraktur, and one character in Hebrew. This is the drawing for this. Here you see how complicated it was in these days to do one character like the fraktur W, and on the right-hand side you see all the characters of the Euler font. I had a commission from the government of Nigeria to do a new typeface which could be used by the different tribes and nations within Nigeria. 400 languages they have, and they want to get out a language, or let's say letter forms, alphabet, which could be used by all of them. Besides the Arabic, the north is Arabic, but the south is Roman, and for all these dialects, we had to find out a solution. And what you see here is the school book alphabet And everything was finished, and there was a coup in Lagos, and they quit all these cultural ideas and stopped everything, and now they have the same disorder as it was before. All the different languages have their own alphabets, special characters to the Roman alphabet. What you see here is also three-dimensional, cut in aluminum, and you see here in the middle a computer component board included in this little sign. It's not little, it's quite big, I must say. Something I did in plexiglass, and it is illuminated from the bottom, and so you have a very nice reflection inside these plexiglass letters. The letters have a thickness of 8 millimeters. Next, please. Now we are closer here to California. This is one of the very first Apple computers, which I did, which I received from Steve Jobs. And at the first day I could use it, I made a design, as you see it. But it didn't work. It was the first design I did. I was nearly finished, and then the bomb appeared. Everything was lost, and I was so unhappy, my first experience with a computer. I was so unhappy that I couldn't eat anything the whole day. My wife could ask my wife. So go back to normal things, that is not to computers too much. This is Renaissance Roman with different kinds of characters and ligatures and for the Scan Graphic Company in Hamburg. Next. Using this type with the old version for a keepsake during a conference in Tokyo. The lettering, the Japanese, is done by, what is his name? Shinohara. Aita Shinohara. Next, please. This I did also for a Japanese company. Desk diary with some calligraphy inside. Also for a Japanese collector who was a fan of Rilke. He wanted to have a Rilke quotation in German. 4 pages of an instruction book. There's one in English, French, Spanish, and German. Now you see the kaleidoscope picture, and it's the Arebo formula with all these mystery inside. What does it mean, the whole thing? There are lots of descriptions, and one of them I wrote on the other side here. It was used also for a puzzle by the Royal Society of Arts in London. So you see, it's not an easy puzzle. My wife is specialized in puzzles, but this is, as he told me, it's very complicated to do. British. Next, please. I did a program called HC program for UAVW in Hamburg. This is a description of the English version and how it works. And you see on the one side, Gutenberg needed 290 characters to get his perfect columns for the 42-line Bible. but we don't have 290 characters, so we have to find other ways. And so we figured out to stretch and to manipulate a little the characters. You don't see it, but you see on the second column, which is this done with the program, that it runs smaller, the hole. And you have not more than two hyphenated words. And so it was quite complicated. I don't want to talk too much about it. Let's go next. Oh. Yeah, that's 91, I think it's all right. As you may know, it was an exhibition here in the library. This is also done with Dr. Knuth. 3.16, Bible text illuminated. And done with calligraphic pages from calligraphers all over the world. I think you saw here the original designs in San Francisco. This is the broadside in which I was working several years. It is a homage to Leibniz, who is the inventor of the dual and binary system, which you use today in all your computers. Nobody knows that this was done in the 18th century already. And this is a description how it works and the sources of the whole thing. He was really a great man. This is William Morris, and with his ideas about air pollution. And this could be written in these days, but this was done 1839. You can't believe what he has foreseen, the conditions which we have around us today. The same in calligraphy, this other was done in type. Was done for an exhibition in Texas. Now we are closer to the end. This is a publication, poetry through typography, and published by Kelly Winderton Press, Kelly is here, in New York City. I think you have one on display upstairs, upstairs. Two pages from this publication. Yeah. This was a funny idea of some friends. I did some cues, and they said, can you do more than only 10? I said, I can do some more. So I ended up with 50, you see. A quotation from your Declaration of Independence, part of the Declaration of Independence by Jefferson in the collection of Jerry Kelly. Then we have here some of my logo designs in all the years put together, different publishers. This on the right-hand side, only for one publisher to find the best solution. And the last one is what he was taken. Next, please. The same here, you're on the left-hand side for the Nuremberg National Museum. Also different variations just to find the best solution. Also here, so you see some American companies here. The Q was for a company, for an organization in Washington, D.C. And below is the logo for the Champion Paper Company. Next, please. Oh, let me go back again. So to helps the Californians. In the center of the left-hand side, you see the logo for the Stanford Library, Friends of the Stanford Library. Next, please. This is Safino Leporello, which you can get here. We have here some of these, which you see the different drawings, alphabets of the Safino with ligatures and all kinds of things. And you see, I think, on your publications which you have here, also a lot of use of Safinos. That is one of the drawings, sketches, or ligatures, or Safino. Next, please. And here you see the drawings, the final drawings. It was started with several hundreds of characters, and then after a while we had to cut it down to four simple alphabets. But it's a long story I wanted to talk about. It's by the way, you can read it on this little booklet. It's a page which shows all my type designs in all the years from 1938 with Gilgenkat, you have seen it, till 1998. And now we are on the end. You see two designs for some covers of publications. One was for the Chicago, and the other one was for the catalog which Jerry Kelly did for the Grolier Club in London, in New York. Can you get now the music? You see, this is something that we have worked on, but just to show it now, it's a description of the music which is used here for the CD-ROM, done by the Abig Trio, a very famous trio in Germany. This is a description of the Abig Trio and shows all the titles of the music which was used during the whole story, beginning with Beethoven and ending up with Felix Mendelssohn Bartholdy, which we hear now. This is the end of the story with all the names of people who are involved in this CD-ROM. Quite a bunch of people you see, and oh, sorry. Can you get it again? Electronics.